Good morning, church. How we doing, everybody? Woo! Let's all stand. Amen? Come on. As I pray, God, we just welcome you, Holy Spirit, in this place. God, we say we don't want to play church. We don't want to just sing songs. God, we want to meet with you today. We want to encounter you today. So I pray as you look down on this place, God, may our worship bless you this morning, God. I pray, change us from the inside out. Let us leave different than when we came in. God, may we honor you with all that we do and say. And all God's people said, amen. Come on, let's worship.
Blessed are those who run to him, who place their hope and confidence in Jesus. He won't forsake them. Blessed are those who seek his face, who bend their knee and fix their gaze on Jesus. They won't be shaken. Come on and praise the Lord with me. Sing if you love his name. Come on and lift your voice with me. He's worthy of all our praise. Blessed are those who walk with him, whose hearts are set on pilgrimage with Jesus. They'll see his glory. Blessed are those who die to live, whose joy it is to give it all for Jesus and for him. Fields of plenty. Bless God in the darkest valley. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God when my hands are empty. Bless God with the praise that cost me. Bless God when nobody's watching. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God when the weapon's forming. Bless God when the walls are falling. Bless God. Always with me. Bless God, for he's always worthy. Every
How many know he's faithful always? Amen? Come on. We say here all the time, we're not here just to play church or sing songs, hear another message. We're here to encounter the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen? How many of you guys just need a touch of the Savior today? Honestly, just raise your hands. I'm going to pray. God, I pray right now, God, you know every situation, every circumstance, every single detail of our lives. God, we come before you, God. We say, God, that we might not be able, but you are. And so we choose today, God, to say that we trust that you are who you say you are. We trust that you know the plans that you have for us, declares the Lord. God, we trust in your plans, God. We trust that you're on the throne, God, that you're sovereign, God, that you are faithful, God. So I just pray right now over every hand raised. God, I pray, God, breakthrough right now in Jesus' name, God, over our lives. Just touch us right now, Jesus. We just say we love you today. Come on, let's sing this out. When did I start to forget all of the great things you did? When did I throw away faith for the impossible? And how did I start to believe that you weren't sufficient for me? Why do I talk myself out of seeing miracles? You are more than able. You are more than able. You are more than
Thank you.
easy for you. I believe it. Come on, sing it over your lives.
You are more than able.
Yes, God.
You are more than able,
Jesus.
You are more than able.
I believe it, God. Oh, you are.
You are more than able. Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Who am I to deny what the Lord can do?
Amen. Can we give a shout of praise? Come on, we praise you, Lord, in faith today, God. We're going to teach you guys a new song today, amen? It's called He's in the Room. Come on.
Of my forsaken, never alone. The God of heaven calls me His own. He's not just seated upon the throne. I know He's right here inside my home. I've got a treasure here in my heart, and in my weakness it won't depart. I have a Savior who will abide. He's not just with me, He lives inside. Just go ask Daniel if our God will bring you out, and He will testify. He shuts the lion's mouth. Go ask those Hebrew boys if He'll stick by your side. They will identify the fourth man in the fire. They'll tell you, oh, He's in the room.
Oh,
search the heavens high, if I search the earth below, if I make my bed in hell, no matter where I go, 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 he's there, he's there, he's there, he's there, he's there, he's there.
Come on. How many know worship is our weapon? Amen? Come on. When you worship in the midst of storms in your life, that's when breakthrough comes. Amen? He has set us free, not so we can live captive and bound, but he set us free so we can live, so we can proclaim his name. How many of you guys have been turned from a grave to a garden? Amen? Come on. Let's sing this out.
See, I searched the world, but it couldn't fail me. Man's empty praise, the treasures of faith, are never enough. But you came along,
amen,
and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love.
Come on.
Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing.
Come on, tell him. Come on. One more time, amen. And oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Can we give a shout of praise today, church? Come on. We praise you, Lord. Yes, God. Well, again, welcome to the Bridge Central Coast, you guys. We're so glad that you're here. Give somebody a hug next to you. Introduce yourself to somebody you don't know. Come on, give somebody a hug. Can we give a round of applause for Andy? Come on. Again, when the body functions, each in its gifting, to the fullness, that's what God's heart is for the church. Amen. It's not just about one person. It's not about one man or even a team of people. It's about one name and all of us joining together to raise his name. So again, we're blessed, Andy Caldwell, to be able to have him here, a part of our teaching team. He's not only just part of our family in this church, but again, he's a watchdog for our county. He does not... How do I put this? I'm not really politically correct, but I can say this way. He's not afraid of speaking truth. Amen? Come on. And how many of you know we need truth? I always tell people, man, if you don't like what Andy says or you want to challenge him on stuff, you better make sure you have your facts straight, because he not only researches and has his facts, but he also knows the word of God. And a lot of people don't know that about him, but he's an amazing scholar. He knows God's word. He loves Jesus and he desires so much to be used by him to preach to his people. So if we can extend our hands, we're going to pray over this man of God. God, thank you so much for Andy. God, again, I bless him today. Holy Spirit, I ask, may your words be his words. Fill him up, God. Give him strength. God, give him supernatural confidence and boldness to release the message that you put on his heart. God, thank you for the gift that he is, that Linda is, that their entire family is, God, here in this church, God, in this house that we call home. God, so again, I thank you for him. God, I pray, God, as he's faithful to serve you, God, to put his life into your hands, God, multiply it. God, use him to touch thousands upon thousands, God, for your name's sake. God, we say we love you. We open up our hearts for the message you put on his heart, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Come on.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you for having me. So all of us are a product of our temperament. Tim LaHaye wrote a phenomenal book called Spirit Control Temperament way back when, that talked about, kind of how you function. It's very deep. And my temperament, there's strengths and weaknesses to all temperaments. Mine was, I would call it an indomitable spirit, which has its pros and cons. And I'll tell you about the first con I ran into. I was 3 or 4 years old, and there was a department store Santa in the store. And of course, I love Santa. So I got in line. And after I told Santa everything I wanted, I got a piece of candy. You know what I did? I got back in line. I got back in line so many times, Santa literally told me to get lost. He told me, I'm not giving you no more candy. I already know what's on your list. Go away. So that was when I was 3 years old, 3 or 4 years old, and a kind of a story of my life in some ways. And then the other part of my life is I grew up Catholic. And whereas there's things I didn't like about my Catholic upbringing, looking back, there's things that I cherish. And but one of the strengths and weaknesses of that is I felt there was a duty to God. There's a duty to God. And the flip side of that is to think that what you do, that God needs you. Not that God chooses to use you, but that God needs you to do things, and that you're going to get, literally, we went to catechism, we got our first communion, or we went to confession, we got stars next to our name, and I always thought that God up there was putting stars next to my name when I did good stuff, and I wanted to be dutiful to God. Well, there are strengths and weaknesses in that, and I'm going to share those with you. So because I grew up Catholic, when I went to UC San Diego, one of my best friends from Lompoc got saved within a day or two by a tremendous student evangelist. And then they tried to lead me to the Lord, and I said, well, I already believe in God. I'm Catholic. And they prayed for me anyway, and when the guy prayed for me, for the first time in my life, I really heard that God loved me. See, I always knew there was a God, but I didn't know him. But I heard, for the first time, I heard that God loved me. And then he gave me a Bible. So I started reading it every day. Didn't know what it meant. Didn't know what I was reading. I tried to just grab one thing out of a chapter. But slowly I changed and I grew in my faith. And finally I got invited by a friend to Calvary Chapel, San Diego. And during the worship, the Holy Spirit filled me, fell on me, and I was quickened and I was born again. I knew God. I didn't respond to an altar call. Never did respond to an altar call. I was just saved. Well, I was in love with God. I heard the audible voice of God. God was using me. He was raising me up. I started a Bible study at college and all this other stuff. And I was doing gangbusters until I met a girl. I fell into sin. And first lesson I learned in my Christian walk, don't pursue spirituality while you're walking in sin. Because the scripture, when Paul says, I'm going to hand so-and-so over to Satan for the destruction of his flesh, I got handed over. And so my best friend, he's a missionary pastor in Mexico, wrote me a letter, says, your house has been destroyed. You can either sit in the ruins and cry or begin to rebuild. So I started to rebuild. And what had happened there was a failure of love. I was a carnal Christian. Almost everybody is a carnal Christian, depending on how deeply they got saved. You're a carnal Christian when you begin. Paul talks about that in Corinthians. Well, because I never responded in an altar call, I just thought, okay, well, that was a failure to love God. I ended up loving something else more than God. Now I got to prove to God that I love him. So now I'm heading for another crash. Because your relationship with God isn't based on how much you love God. If it is, we're all going to hell. Okay? Your relationship with God is based on his love for you. And to the degree you respond to that, you're saved and sanctified, right? Well, so I'm rebuilding my life. I'm trying to return to God as my first love. God's using me in people's lives. So what I'm trying to say is, I'm not, even though I'm going to talk to you about another false foundation, I didn't know there was a false foundation in my life. So, you know, I used to be able to see the Holy Spirit resting on people. If I saw the Holy Spirit, I knew I had a word for that person. I'd had dreams. I sent a letter to somebody. I didn't know they were going to commit suicide. The letters turned them away from suicide. Prayed for somebody once that hadn't, and I didn't even know what I was praying for. Listen, in my life, God uses me in spite of me, not because of me. And anyway, I prayed. They were able to conceive for the first time. I'd read the Bible. It says, this is pure and undefiled religion to visit orphans and widows in their distress. So I thought, I don't know any orphans. I know where I can find a lot of widows, and that's in a convalescent home. So I used to go to this convalescent home once or twice a week, and I'd just walk in and say, is there somebody here that I could just visit? Somebody needs visitors. My mom worked in one when I was little, and I used to walk in there, and those people broke my heart, even as a little kid. They were so lonely, just absolutely lonely. So I went in this one, and I ended up visiting this one lady week after week after week. And one day I walked in there, and she was gone. And there was this other person that was in the room, and she was all crippled up from arthritis. I mean, something fierce. And she couldn't talk. And I used to just wave to her and say, how are you doing? But when this one lady wasn't there, and I turned to leave, that lady just reached out her crippled hand towards me. So I walked over there. And I grabbed her hand and I thought, God, I don't know what to do. I don't even know if she can hear me. And the other thing about me, besides getting told by a Santa to get lost, I was in kindergarten. I signed up to sing in the talent contest. And I'm singing my heart out, my sister and her best friend in front row laughing. My mom's in the back row trying not to laugh. Why? Because my dad used to tell me, you cannot carry a tune in a bucket. Didn't matter. So in second grade, this is the end of it. This is my, do you guys ever watch American Idol, what I call the reject shows? Well, I had my reject show in second grade, not in national television when I was 20-something years old. I got a D in music. My mom asked the teacher, why'd you give him a D? Well, he loves to sing. She goes, that's the problem, Mrs. Caldwell. Every morning he takes the entire class off key on my country, 'tis of thee. She gave me a D, you know, no A for effort. That was before we had participation trophies in America, okay? So anyway, I didn't know what to do with this lady. I did not know what to do. So I started singing Amazing Grace. So my hand's in her hand. She grabs my hand. Just kissing my hand. And it wasn't because I was a good singer, okay? I realized years later, I'd been visiting the wrong woman in that room. But God used me anyway, right? Not because of me, but in spite of me. So anyway, so my life's going good. There's fruit, there's gifts, there's character development. I'm thinking I'm doing pretty good here. So I said, hey, God, how about blessing me now? This was big mistake number two, okay? How about healing me of my asthma? Well, instead, I ended up having to get 14 shots a week, allergy shots a week. Seven in four in one arm, three in the other arm twice a week. I wanted to be married. This girl that I was half dating didn't even really like her, but I thought she'll do. She's a disciple. She realized she didn't like me. So that was over. So that was one thing. All four things I prayed about just blew up, right? I got ticked off. I got ticked off at God. Is this how you treat the people that are trying to please you, trying to serve you, trying to obey you? It went downhill from there. God, first thing he told me, I don't know you anything. I don't know you anything. Then I got really mad. So I went from the carnal Christian to the next phase. I don't know you anything. Then he says, you're nothing but a Pharisee. And I still didn't repent. I still got mad. How dare you? I'm not a Pharisee. I'm seeking you, serving you. You're blessing me. How are you calling me a Pharisee? Then he told me this. This was the killer. You would have crucified me too. That was a Pharisee's problem. Their righteousness was filthy rags, and God called them on it. We talk about the dead bones. They put a sepulcher around the dead bones and whitewashed it and called it a day. I went from carnality to Pharisee. Well, then I just kind of half said, I'm not going to be a disciple anymore. And I got into sin, and this time I couldn't get out. I was in bondage. And for the first time in my life, I needed to meet Jesus as my Savior. I had my altar call on my motorcycle. And the scripture came, because I said, God, I'm screwed. Get me out of this. Get me back. And that scripture in Isaiah came, come now, let us reason together. Says the Lord, though your sins are scarlet, they will be as white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, they will be like wool. And he pulled me out. He pulled me out. So I understand the scriptures, run in such a way as to win, ask and seek and knock and pray without ceasing. But what I'm going to share with you today is a different context, a greater context to those things. And anything I say here doesn't mean you don't have to do that. Anything I say doesn't mean you don't have to obey and seek the Lord and seek to serve. But I'm going to just give you a different context for these things. In Isaiah 30, there's a promise. This is a promise wrapped up in a rebuke, okay? It says, therefore, the Lord longs to be gracious to you. And therefore he waits on high to have compassion on you. For the Lord is a God of justice. How blessed are those who long for him. O inhabitant or people in Zion, inhabitant in Jerusalem, you will weep no longer. He'll be gracious to you at the sound of your cry. When he hears it, he will answer you. Oh, the Lord has given you the bread of privation. That literally means deprivation. And the water of oppression. They were deprived and oppressed. He, your teacher, will no longer hide himself. Your eyes will behold your teacher. You'll hear a word behind you. This is the way you walk in it whenever you turn to the right or the left. So as Pastor Fred likes to say, where there's a therefore, you have to ask yourself, what is it there for? Right? There's two therefores in this one. You get two for one therefore in this scripture. Well, to understand what the therefore is there, you got to back up a couple of verses. But before I do that, realize what this passage is saying. They were lacking God's grace and compassion. They were weeping. They had deprivation, oppression. God was hiding from them. They were having trouble hearing God's voice. Why was God waiting? What was he longing for? What is the therefore there for? Well, in Isaiah 30, 15, a couple verses ahead, it tells you the answer. For thus says the Lord God and the Holy One of Israel. He has said this, in repentance and rest you will be saved. In quietness and trust is your strength. But you were not willing. See, I read that first part. I had that thing memorized. And I had the second part memorized. But I always missed the part about you were not willing. So we're going to talk about repentance a lot. But let me say this. There was two great awakenings in America. There hasn't been a third one. There's been some awakenings, but only two great ones that had a profound effect that changed society. One of them was in the times of Jonathan Edwards. His famous sermon was titled Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. And then Finney was the second great awakening. And he too, we have no concept of this in America anymore. Zero concept of this. When they preached the word, people screamed in agony. They felt their wickedness. They sensed God's holiness. And they screamed out, what must I do to be saved? And they literally would come up to the sinner's bench and wrestle to be able to receive God's grace and mercy. They had to work this out. They had to repent. They're under, what I was saying, under heavy, heavy conviction. It wasn't a tinge of the conscience. It was something like Paul or whoever would just rip open their vest and cry out and repent in dust and ashes. It was extremely powerful conversion experiences. And then D.L. Moody, later on, still in the 1800s, late 1800s, most famous evangelist in American Europe, by far. Second most important man, historians say, second most important man in the 1800s after Abraham Lincoln. This is who D.L. Moody was. D.L. Moody preached that same kind of a gospel until this young man followed him back from Europe and ended up preaching at his church when D.L. Moody was gone. D.L. Moody had told him, let him preach. And he came back and D.L. Moody said to his wife, what did he preach on? God loves sinners. D.L. Moody basically said, that's heresy. God judges sinners. God condemns sinners unless they repent. Well, his wife says, honey, you need to listen to him. The guy preached on John 3:16 seven nights in a row. And D.L. Moody said, my heart began to thaw. My heart began to thaw. That was an opening in the gospel where they started preaching God's love, not just God's judgment and condemnation. Well, fast forward to where we are today. We went from sinners in the hands of an angry God to God in the hands of angry sinners. The gospel now is God loves you just the way you are. You don't need to repent. He loves you just as the way you are. You don't need to pick up your cross. God loves you just the way you are. And in that essence, we don't want to tick people off. So Jesus was the most loving, kind, person who ever walked the face of the earth, the only sinless person who walked the face of the earth. Yet he said the world hated him. Why? Because he testified that his deeds were evil. We don't want to be persecuted, so we don't say anything. And thereby we nullify the cross, which the gospel says is the power of God for salvation. So we do a good job here of talking about repentance from sin. So I'm going to go through these pretty quick. So the whole gospel, you have to remember this. Almost every promise of God is not unconditional. It is conditional. And for forgiveness, the gospel literally says a gospel of repentance for the forgiveness of sin. Repentance for the forgiveness of sin. So John the Baptist came preaching a baptism of repentance. In James, it talks about you adulteresses. You know, if you're a friend with the world, you're an enemy of God. An enemy? You know, Jesus, don't love the world or the things in the world. Everything in the world is passing away, and it's lust. The one who abides is the one going to do the will of God forever. Now, we're all sinners. We will all sin. But the question is, if you're a mature Christian, you will no longer sin willfully. If you're a spirit-filled Christian, you will no longer sin on purpose because you don't care. And in Hebrews, it says, if we go on sinning willfully after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice, but a terrifying expectation of judgment, a fury of fire. He's writing this to Christians, mind you. Severe punishment. Why? Because you're trampling underfoot the Son of God. You're insulting the Holy Ghost. And so we need to preach, go back to preaching Christ in Him crucified, which is the essence of salvation, and keep a tension between God's judgment and wrath versus His love and His mercy. We have to hold those things in tension. So, you know, you can have the work of God choked out of your life, and you can have the word of God choked out of your life. By the worries of the world, deceitfulness of riches, desires of other things, the parable of the sower and the seed. A surface Christian, this is his warning about a surface Christian. The seed just falls on the surface and Satan comes and takes the seed. It never does anything. It's just there and it's gone. A shallow Christian, the seed gets down in there, but it's hitting all rocks because you're shallow. And then finally, the worldly Christian, the weeds come up and choke it out and make it unfruitful. And all of those things are things that we need to repent of and be cognizant of. And so there's two types of repentance. One of them was repentance from sin, but the other one lost on the church is repentance from dead works. In Hebrews in chapter 6, verse 1, and in Hebrews 9:14, it talks about a foundation, not having a foundation of dead works. And that God needs to cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve a living God. What does that mean? It's something you're doing for God as if He needs you. It's something you're doing for God in your own strength and based on your own religiosity. Trying to appeal, make yourself feel better about yourself. So, like, and it's mostly it's just religion versus relationship. So, example given, communion. Communion could be a dead work. So, the communion is for us to remember that Jesus died for us, shed His blood for us, and gave His life for us. That's what we're supposed to remember when we go to communion. And the scripture tells us, and this is one thing the Catholic Church still has right. You go to confession before you go to communion. Go to confession before you go to communion, i.e., tell your pastor or somebody the sins in your life so that you're not just keeping them hidden, you're revealing them, and they come to the light, they lose their power. But also, it's a thing of humility and transparency. Well, what the bottom line is a communion cup should have a warning label on it. You know, they have a warning label on a stroller, remove your kid before you fold the stroller, okay? We need a warning label on a communion cup. Because what does it say? If you eat this in an unworthy manner, you're not eating and drinking salvation. You're eating and drinking judgment on yourself. You're not going to be saved by the body and blood of Jesus. You're going to be held guilty. You can make communion a dead work. There's three types of righteousness. There's no righteousness. You're a sinner and you don't care. There's self-righteousness, which what I was, a righteousness based on your own works and efforts. But third, the right kind of righteousness comes from faith. It's called a gift of righteousness. It's something God gives you by influencing and affecting you by way of his presence in your life. But this problem, this messing up and going back to works, it happened in the first century with the churches that Paul himself planted. He told the Galatians, you foolish Galatians. He said, you're fools. You're bewitched. Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified before you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by hearing by faith? Are you now being perfected by the flesh after having begun by the Spirit? Does he who provides the Spirit and work miracles among you do it by the works of the law or by hearing my faith? So here's the problem. There's two big words. It's called justification and sanctification. Justification is God's declared you just from your sins because he died for you. Sanctification is him making that a reality. One's being saved from the penalty of sin. The other one's being saved from the presence and power of sin. Okay? You can't do any of that on your own. You can't get saved by grace and mercy and then get perfected by your own effort, will, or desire. Romans 9 says, it doesn't depend on the man who wills or runs. I always thought it did. I got to try harder. I got to want it more. I got to try harder. I got to want it more. And I never reached anything because it doesn't depend on that. It depends on God's mercy. It depends on what he did for you, not anything that you can do for him. And in Acts, Paul said to the think tank of the day, God is not served by human hands. He doesn't need us. He chooses to use us. He doesn't need us. How is that? He doesn't need anything. He himself gives to all life and breath and all things. All of life is a gift. You can't earn it. You can't work it. You can't deserve it. You can only receive it. And secondly, choose. These are the things I've come down to in my life. Choosing God and obeying God while he creates the capacity in you for him to be your dwelling place. So I'm going to blow through these. Next one, because we talk a lot about these works. You don't want dead works. The works have to be wrought by God because he's not served by human hands. And Jesus said, I don't do anything on my own initiative, but the Father in me is doing his works. He says, I cannot do anything of myself unless I see the Father doing it. He limited himself. So like when he went into that pool where he asked the guy, do you want to get well? And the guy said, nobody there to put me in the pool. And Jesus brought the living water to him and healed him. Jesus walked by thousands of people to the one person God had sent him to. Walked right by him. Because he could only do what the Father was doing. So here's the punchline as to how to understand this thing about works. You don't work for God. You are his work. Okay? We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. You are his work. You are what he is doing. And out of that relationship and out of that effect, you can work the works of God. But how do you work the works of God? You simply believe. The people ask Jesus, what do we do to do the works of God? And he says, don't work for the food that perishes. What do we do? He says, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent. Believing in Jesus is your work. Everything else will flow out of that. Regard to reading your Bible can be a dead work. The Pharisees knew the Bible better than anybody in history, could recite it backwards, forwards, inside out. But they didn't know God. The demons in Jesus' time recognized Jesus, but the Pharisees didn't recognize him. John, he says, you search the Jesus. You search the scriptures, thinking in them you have eternal life. But it's these that bear witness to me, and you're unwilling to come to me. When you go to the Bible, don't go to the Bible. Come to God through the Bible. Okay? Don't just stop there with regarding prayer. Does your life consist of you telling God what he needs to do and what you want from him? Is that your prayer life? That was mine, and I can fall into that any day of the week. Is your prayer life consist of you telling God what he needs to do and what you want or need from him? Who's on the throne if that's your prayer life? It's not God. You know, the scriptures tell you to draw near to listen rather than to offer the sacrifice of fools, to not use meaningless repetition. This is Jesus. They suppose they will be heard for their many words. Don't be like them. Your Father knows what you need before you ask him. So what is the quiet time? The quiet time is fellowship with God. The quiet time is coming into his presence. Yes, prayer has a part. Yes, reading the Bible has a part. But don't forget what the goal is. The goal isn't you reading your list. The goal isn't you just doing your daily duty of reading a chapter or whatever in the Bible. It's coming to God. It's coming to God. Tithing. Scripture says you can't serve God and mammon. Here's how tithing becomes a dead work. We all believe this because it's true, that if you give unto the Lord, he'll be faithful to give unto you. But if your motivation is that he will give unto you, you just made a dead work out of tithing. The motivation can't be selfishness. It has to be self-sacrifice. It has to be stewardship. See, part of my wrong thinking growing up is if I do, and this is Job, this is a part of the lesson in Job. If I do what I'm supposed to do, God will do what he promised to do. Thereby, his promise becomes based on my efforts and my works and my obedience. We want it to be based on his grace and his mercy. You don't want to use God to get mammon. John Wesley said this, and this is the highlight: gain all you can and save all you can, not to get all you can, but to give all you can. Look that up. With regard to serving, Martha was distracted by her serving, while Mary chose to listen to the Lord at his feet. Anything could become a dead work. So with regard to rest, the scriptures say that the goal in the Old Testament and the goal in the New Testament is to rest, to enter into his rest. And God accomplishes this but through obedience, but also mostly by believing in him, trusting in him, and his ability to lead you to his ability to work in you an obedient heart, in spirit, and trusting that everything that he's promised you, he will accomplish concerning you by way of his word, prayer, the Holy Spirit, fellowship, and the like. In regard to quietness, repentance and rest, quietness and trust, the optimum scripture there is in Psalms: be still and know that I am God. The busier you are, and this is what's happened in our society, you are wrapped up in social media and entertainment nearly all day long. And the scripture tells you to come to the quiet. Come to the quiet place to meet with God. And in silence, the scripture talks about being quiet and being still and before God. In trust, it talks about trusting in the Lord. To not be afraid that it's God's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. And that if you don't want to just trust in the Lord, you want God to become your trust. See, it's all about relationship, not religion. It's all about relationship. So the second half of this message is take off your shoes. So this has to do with the first part was salvation. This is now dealing with service. In the life and ministry of Joshua, God called him and told him, God's telling Joshua this, you shall give this people possession of the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. You. But the first thing that happened when he goes into that promised land, he meets a man with the sword drawn. Joshua goes up to him. The guy's got a sword out. Are you on our side or are you on somebody else's side? Are you for us or against us? The angel of the Lord said, neither. I'm captain of the Lord's host. Joshua, God ain't on your side. You have to make sure you're on God's side. Okay? See, we have this thing where we want to be the center of God's universe. And we want God's purpose and blessing and plans and providence to circle around us. We're not the story. Jesus is the story. We want to be on God's side. Even if he called us to do something, the truth there is you can't do it. He has to do it. And you have to follow him as he does it. And that's how you do it. In partnership with him. In other words, when he told him, take off your shoes, he told him at that moment, take off your shoes. He goes, you don't own this, Joshua. You don't own this. I own this. Take off your shoes. And see, what Ezekiel tells us, this is a promise of the new covenant. He says, he tells Israel, it's not for your sake that I'm going to act. I'm going to give you a new heart. I'm going to put a new spirit within you, and I'm going to cause you to obey me. But it's not because you're worthy. It's not because you desire it. It's not because you will it. It's not because you'll work for it. It's because of my namesake. It's because I've chosen to put my love on you. I've chosen to call you and to equip you and to save you. It's all about God. You're his workmanship. You're the receiver of that grace and that mercy. In Matthew, Jesus says that, you know, nobody can come to the Father or no one knows the Son unless the Son reveals him. Come to me, he said. Come to me, you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I'm gentle, I'm humble, and you will find rest for your souls. So the question is, are you pursuing humility in your life or strength? Are you pursuing and valuing brokenness and contriteness? Because the sacrifice God wants out of your life is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. Who does God look to? To those who are humble and contrite of spirit and who tremble at his word. So what is Christianity? It is praying without seeking. It's, you know, it's obeying, it's serving, it's fellowshipping. But the greater context of it, if you want to be great, humble yourself. If you want a great prayer life, learn to listen rather than speak. If you want to be strong, embrace your weakness. If you want God to increase in your life, then you need to decrease. If you want to lead, learn how to serve. If you want to live, then die to yourself. If you want to find eternal life, then lose your life in this world. The greatest prophetic word I've ever seen to describe where the church is today came from the founder of the Salvation Army. He wrote this well over probably 120, 130 years ago. The chief danger that confronts the coming century will be religion without the Holy Ghost. You can't be a Christian without the Holy Ghost. Christianity without Christ, that's trying to be a Christian but not picking up your cross and not looking to his cross. Forgiveness without repentance. The word in our society for that today is tolerance. Tolerance is forgiveness without repentance. The gospel does not preach tolerance. Salvation without regeneration, i.e. I'm saved, but I'm not changed. A.W. Tozer said, if you confess something and it makes no difference in you, doesn't make any difference to God either. Finally, what Justin's been talking about, politics without God. Then finally, heaven without hell. We don't talk about hell anymore because it offends people. Well, Jesus, the kindest, most loving person, offended people every day to the point that people in his own hometown tried to throw him off a hill, a cliff. We need the Holy Spirit. We need to preach and live the message of the cross. We have to pick up our own cross. We need to repent not just from sin, but from dead works. Repent from dead works. Find out what is the Father doing? What is the Father saying? Give yourself to that, and you'll find yourself a co-worker with God. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, please help us. We want to be participating in the third great awakening, God, because our society needs it so bad. The church needs it. We need it. Thank you for this opportunity. Please bless your word. Bless the hearers. Thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Can we all stand? That was a powerful word from Andy. Like we say, what we give here, it's all about truth. It's knowing, are you receptive to that truth? Or do we have a hardened heart? It's all about the softens of your heart. The soil is of your heart. If your heart, if you have a heart of stone, the Lord wants to give you a heart of flesh so you could receive that word. So we are not the person who the enemy comes that we hear this powerful word. And then the enemy comes before we even walk out of these doors and he wants to steal this word. Or are you like the rock? Ground where you get excited for a second, but then as soon as trials or tribulations come up, the testings, you guys fall away. Or are you getting choked out by the word? I pray in the mighty name of Jesus that this word went on good ground. So then, and again, what we do every time before we leave a word like this, it needs a seal in our hearts. So the enemy cannot go over there and pluck that out. I love what he talked about. So many things of what he said, like the one-liners. I love the one-liner quotes. Like, man, what stuck out to me even first service and second service was what I would have crucified. Jesus said, you would have crucified me too. You would have done that. And what Brother Andy was talking about, dead works. If you got to do, like, you got to earn. So many of us in here feel that we got to earn God's love. We got to earn it. None of us could earn it. All of us deserve death. All of us were born into sin. But all you got to do is receive. Where that's when we talk about. We don't have to serve. We get to serve. No one has to tell me, thank you. Lord, I thank you that I'm doing this for you. Lord, I'm coming with you in humility. I'm coming to you in brokenness. Don't come here and do anything in dead works. What is dead works? What we talk about as well. Coming to church and not applying this to your life is dead works. That's why I say going to church does absolutely nothing. Now applying it to your life, now that changes people's lives. Don't go to church, become the church. Become love, become grace, become mercy. But if you are not in the word of God, you don't know what truth is. Now you're going to be tolerant to all the lies and the schemes of the enemy, because it's the truth that sets you free. Amen. But again, God sends nobody to hell. I say this all the time. God sends nobody to hell, and God leads nobody to a life of destruction. Our decisions do. So what decisions are you making today? Are you going to decide to apply this word of God to your life and make it real? Are you going to be a hearer of the word, or are you going to be a doer of the word? Are you going to be a foolish man who hears these words and does not put them into practice? Or are you going to be like a wise man who put the word of God into practice? That's who the Lord. But in order for you guys to get there, we have to have that contrite, that humility. We have to deny ourselves, pick up our cross and follow him. It's not about you, it's about him. Amen? Let me just close this. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for what you did here today, Lord. I thank you, Father, it's not by chance that anyone who was here today was by your divine plan and purpose, Lord. I pray in the mighty name of Jesus, my Father. If no one has met you, Father, I thank you, Lord, that you are here drawing your sons and your daughters to you right now in the mighty name of Jesus, Father. I thank you, Father, may you remove the heart of flesh, a heart of stone, and give them a heart of flesh, Father God. Holy Spirit, I just thank you, Father, may you give them, Father God, a hunger and a thirst, my Father, for your word and for your righteousness. And every time that they look at themselves in the mirror, my Father, may they know, Father, that you called them, that you chose them, you created them, Lord, in your likeness and your image, Father. And because of that, Father God, we don't have to go be dead works, Father God, just seeing how many people love us. Lord, we know that you love us, Lord. We know that you chose, that you went to the cross for your blood, Father God, went to the cross, and you prayed, paid every single one of our sins, Father God, for yesterday, today, and forever. And because of that, Lord, make us not do that in vain, what you did on the cross, Lord. Father God, may we apply that blood of Jesus to our life. And once we apply that blood of Jesus to our life, we'll never be the same. So, Father God, I just thank you, Father God, what you did here today. Lord, I seal this word, Father God. I seal this word in your children's hearts, Father God. So we just love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. If you guys need prayer for anything, we got an amazing prayer team up here. Come on up here. We love you guys. If not, we'll see you next Sunday.